is our strength.
How do you mention strength and falling back on that strength? How do we address, I'd like to know your perspective on what's happened to the black church once the anchor for it all, no matter what was happening outside of our community, no matter how severe racism was, the black church was that institution, was that place. We now find that a lot of the ministers have engaged themselves in some of this stuff, and everything's changed.
Well, I think there have been changes, yes, and it's part of the same process that I mentioned, imitating the majority in our society. The black church, I think, is still our strength. It's still our best way to go forward because it's our major institution, that has survived, apart from the barbershops and the Undertaker parlors. It's the major institution that has survived so-called integration as a black institution. And there's Reverend Jackson here, and of course he's part of the black church.
As well as back from South Africa.
Fabulous.
Speaking of the black church.
You're on the radio talking, you're on the
television. She's a little bit overwhelmed. Can you come over here, sir?
I am.
Could you please introduce yourself?
My name is Alan Boshack. I come from Cape Town, South Africa, and I'm very, very happy to see my friend Reverend Jesse Jackson this morning.
Well, what are you doing here? Why aren't you at the World Cup? My goodness, I changed places with you. Give me a ticket back to Cape Town or Johannesburg.
Well, the only reason why I would leave the World Cup is Bush has something going on.
You know what, Reverend, I mentioned a few minutes ago all this history in this place. I am like almost on the floor. Somebody bring something to resuscitate me here. How are you? It's just incredible. I guess Jesse Jackson can bring them all.
Yes, he can.
He can bring them all. And we got Ernest Green from Little Rock Knight. Totally, totally incredible. Dr. Garvey, thank you so very much.
It's been my pleasure.
No, you don't get away. And I hope that Ernest Green has a few more minutes. South Africa comes to Chicago. The air must be really clean in Cape Town. I mean, it looks wonderful.
The air is wonderful in Cape Town. The spirit is great. The people are responding very well to the World Cup. The hard question about the World Cup and what all that means for our people in terms of sustainability and development, those are the questions that we will only begin to ask when the World Cup is over.
I was about to say that. I'm sure that analysis. And has there been much conversation to date about what that brings?
Yeah, there's been a very serious conversation. Not everybody is convinced that the World Cup will bring all the benefits to all of the people. In fact, the great fear is that in the end, the World Cup might only benefit an elite group of people already very settled in the economic situation. It might certainly will benefit FIFA internationally. But the question is whether those benefits cannot just be trickled down, because that's not what we want, but can be made real in terms of economic and social development, bring dignity to people's lives, build jobs that are sustainable, bring a vision for the future, to help the children open up those doors of opportunities that we know can be created. And that will be the test of how successful the World Cup will have been in South Africa. And that's what we're going to be sitting down talking about a month from now.
You have lived through perhaps the most important, one of the most important chapters of history in South Africa. And I'm just blown away here as you stand here with Reverend Jackson. And I remember Stephen Biko. I remember all of that. Just thinking about Biko the other day. And here you are in Chicago. Your country has changed. And when you go through that kind of that historical transformation, there's still a tremendous amount of work to be done. How fast has South Africa moved since apartheid?
We have only just begun. We have not yet begun to scratch the surface. I think I can say that I am grateful for much that we have been able to achieve there. Anybody who walked into South Africa now will be able to see there is change. What our concern is that the change ought to be reflected in the lives of those people who need it most, the poorest of the poor. And that is still about 15% of our country who live in dire, extreme poverty. And unless you develop not moments like the World Cup that we hope will bring some benefit to the people, but unless you develop sustainable economic policy based on the redistribution of wealth and based on equality for all people and based on creating opportunities for the young people, education, all of those things, then the gains that we have been making will slip away. And the thing is, of course, we have to be very, very vigilant. Because there is a black government in power does not mean that justice is being done. Because there is a black government in power does not mean that all the needs of the people are being serviced. And I always talk about we must respond to the people, not just in terms of what they need, but in terms of what they deserve. And that's the kind of conversation we're having in South Africa.
Reverend Alan Bosack, he has been a tremendous warrior. It is such a pleasure to have this opportunity to talk with you. Our hearts have been for many, many years with the people of South Africa, and they still are. And I thank you so much for talking with me.
Well, thank you very much. The reason why I'm here is I joked in the beginning that, I mean, the role that Bush has played, the role that the civil rights movement has played, and who had become the anti-apartheid movement in this country, the role that Reverend Jesse Jackson has played, those are not momentary things that once you get your freedom, you forget about all of that. Those are solidarity-based friendships and relationships. And it asks the question, what is it that we together can do now that the situation is changing in the United States and in South Africa? If our people's situation is changing, what can we do together to continue the fight for social justice? And so that's why I'm being drawn to this place like a magnet. So thank you for giving me the opportunity. I really do appreciate it.
You know, to think for a moment here that you, Nelson Mandela, Bishman, Desmond Tutu are all still here. That is just a wonderful thing.
That is a wonderful thing.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
When we take that, I tell you people, unbelievable. Reverend Alan Bosack, so many of you remember his story, his work in South Africa, the great fight against apartheid, and I tell you, the work has not been completed. When we come back, we're gonna talk with a gentleman who was a fighter, who helped change the course of history in America from an educational, and we talked a few minutes ago with Dr. Julian Garvey about desegregation, who changed things in Little Rock, Arkansas. It's an incredible story. It's an American story, and we're going to share.